Well, we're talking with Dr. Richard Jacobs, who's going to be one of the presenters on the Big Concussion Summit that's taking place at the Red Lion Hotel in Richland on May 20th. It's a very important event. If you have a child or a teen or anybody who plays sports, and we especially want to emphasize coaches. Well, Dr. Jacobs, very pleased to be a part of this and let people know about it. What inspired the Cadillac Neurological Resource Center and yourself and others to put together this Concussion Summit?
Well, John, I think it's pretty obvious that concussions have become a major concern in our youth sports and even up into our professional sports over the last 10 to 15 years. And there's been a lot of change in that period of time as to how we treat concussions. And so certainly this has been inspired by just the need to educate not only the community, but even physicians on how to recognize concussions as well as how to treat them. Not to be afraid of concussions, but to recognize that they're a part of sport, they're a part of life, and that awareness is the key.
Absolutely. And like I've told people, unless you've been living in a cave, if you watch any sports channel, not a week or two goes by. I'm trying to remember his name, the gentleman for the 49ers, I believe it's Bolin or middle linebacker, a gentleman who's only played for a year or two in the NFL, is already retiring because he feels that he's had some hits to the head that he hasn't recovered, and he just feels it. He feels like there's some issues there.
Exactly, and I think that is something that we're becoming more aware of, too, and that is there's long-term consequences of repetitive trauma to the head. Mm-hmm. We don't know at what level that repetitive trauma will start causing some changes in a person's personality, their moods. There's certainly a correlation between some depression and anxiety and personality difficulties with people who have had these repetitive injuries. And I thought I was very taken by that particular case as well, as here is a young man kind of in his prime, has achieved what most football players really dream of, playing in the NFL, and yet he's willing to give that up after a year. So I think that, again, is just a stark example of the concern for concussions in our society. Another thing that just happened, John, is there's this lawsuit with the NFL.
I've heard about that,
And the judge recently increased the potential limits of payouts. And there's a thought that over, you know, decades, that could go as high as $1 billion. And I thought that was very interesting and, again, emphasizes kind of why we are doing this.
Absolutely. And I finally remembered his name. It's Chris Borland of the 49ers. Now, what's going to be happening here on May 20th at the Red Lion in Richland, and we'll give people the contact information to where they can register. It's a free event as well. What are the parents and coaches and other people that come there? What you're going to be doing is kind of laying out the state of the union. Where are we now, especially with youth and teen, because it's kind of a trickle down in high school kids. What are you seeing now in the lower levels of sports? And this would include the Leistet situation. What are you seeing now with the lower levels of sports when it comes to concussions?
Well, certainly we see the potential for concussion in all sports, even sports such as track and field, gymnastics, cheerleading. It's not just football. It's not just hockey. It's not just lacrosse, the more physical, contact-oriented sports. You know, concussions really are a part of life. Concussions as a result of sport is only the third leading cause of concussions in our society. We actually see more concussions from motor vehicle accidents and falls than we do from sport.
Wow, I did not know that.
Exactly. You would think by, as you said, watching TV and watching a sporting event or reading the newspaper that it's only contained to sports, but it's not. It's a fact of life. It happens whether we are participating in sports or not. Our main emphasis at these sessions, and there are two of them, the initial session or the earlier of the two sessions is focused more on the medical provider, primary care physicians, physician's assistants, athletic trainers. It'll be more medically oriented and maybe a little bit more complex. But we want to bring them all up to speed, as you say, on what the state of the union is with concussion care, concussion recognition. And then the second session will be more focused on coaches, on parents, on teachers, on school administrators. The one real big challenge we've had is now going to the next level. Our coaches are actually required to have concussion training. If they're involved in youth sports, that is part of the Lystat law that you spoke of earlier. And now we need a more of an awareness of teachers in addition to parents, because concussions don't just affect a student-athlete's ability to perform on the athletic field. It's also impacting their daily lives, sitting in a classroom, being focused, being able to listen to the teacher, being able to learn, going home and being able to interact with their family. All these things are or can be impacted. And it's not just for a day or two. We see concussed young people who have symptoms for 2, 3, 4 weeks. It is true that 90% or 80 to 90% of concussions clear within 7 to 10 days. But there are those who continue to have symptoms for a prolonged period of time and need extra rest. And that is really the primary treatment for a concussion is rest, both mental and physical.
Well, I know, speaking of the concussion training, I've coached youth football in Kennewick for a number of years. And this last year, we had to go through a pretty thorough online training program, and we had to be certified. It's part of that NFL Heads Up program.
Yes.
And it really opens your eyes, as you said, not just for sports, but you go, oh, well, oh my gosh, that kid that fell off the monkey bars at the playground, you know, it really opens your eyes and makes you look for the signs and symptoms and things like that.
Yes, so true. And oftentimes I will see patients who had a rather innocuous blow to the body or the head, and it really wasn't recognized for several days that, gosh, maybe he has a concussion and we should have this checked out. His behavior or her behavior has been off some, not performing in the classroom, up to their level, and then somebody thinks back, oh yes, they fell off the playground equipment, or they ran into a tree while playing football at home or something.
Yeah, and it's not just, you know, oh well, you don't have a headache anymore, you're fine. It goes way beyond that.
Very true. There are many subtle signs and symptoms of having a head injury, and that will be emphasized at these meetings. Dr. Stan Herring, who's the team, one of the team physicians for the Seattle Mariners as well as the Seattle Seahawks, he is internationally renowned for his expertise in concussion care. He is the founder of the Seattle Concussion Clinic and really is the impetus behind the Lystat law, making it through the legislature and becoming law in the state of Washington. And it is really the foundation of concussion laws in the rest of the 49 states.
So, and of course, Lystat, the young man over in the Seattle area who had sustained a significant hit at a football game and ended up with some significant neurological problems that he really had to battle through. And through a lot of courage and effort, he's kind of become a youth spokesman for the concussion awareness movement. And I've seen this law in effect in our own youth sport leagues. We've had some kids that have taken some hits, and they are not allowed to return to play until they have been medically cleared by a physician. And I think that's a very good rule.
that's a cornerstone of the Lystedt law, and that is if there is suspicion for someone having a concussion, and even if you're not sure, we have a saying in sport now, when in doubt, sit them out. Mm-hmm. If you have any suspicion, and it's really incumbent on all adults at the event, in a supervisory role, to step forward and to be aware of this and to take action on this point. Our officials, umpires, referees, coaches, administrators, if they see something that they question, that there's a possibility of a concussion, mm-hmm. then they really need to evaluate that person on the field. And if that suspicion remains, then that person...
And at this time, Dr. Jacobs, we'd like to take an opportunity to give people the information on how they can get involved in the Concussion Summit. Go to cadlec.org/KNRC, cadlec.org/KNRC, or they can call 509-943-8455, 509-943-8455 for the Concussion Summit, Red Lion Richland, May 20th, 6:30 p.m. That's the contact information to get registered. And again, it's free, but you have to register. Well, Dr. Jacobs, we appreciate you taking some time out of your busy schedule to speak with us. And we are looking forward to yours and the rest of the presentations on May 20th at the Red Lion in Richland, the Cadillac Neurological Resource Center, with the very important Concussion Summit. And again, thanks for your time.
John, thank you so much for making this available to me. Just let me tell all of your listeners that this is a huge opportunity to go and listen to people who really have been on the ground floor of this movement of making our sports safer for our children, our youth, and it's a tremendous opportunity. I'm humbled to be a part of it, and I am really encouraging people to come out on May 20th and to learn.